السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي رب زدني علما رب يسر ولا تعسر وتمن بالخير ثم أما بعد والحمد لله. Respected brothers and sisters, viewers and listeners, alhamdulillah and welcome to another lesson of Riyadus Saliheen, Hadith lessons from Riyadus Saliheen, live from here in Darul Ummah, alhamdulillah. Over the past few weeks, we've been not so consistent with our durus, and that's for a few reasons. From them is the whole process of reopening the masjid. This it's been quite busy here in Darul Ummah, alhamdulillah. As you know, we've now reopened for the four salahs daily. We've opened for the Asr, Maghrib, Isha and Fajr. At the Dhuhr is still, inshallah, we're waiting to make necessary arrangements before we can open for that as well, inshallah, azza wa jal. Nonetheless, inshallah, with alhamdulillah Ramadan and this lockdown slowly, I suppose, easing, and Allahu a'lam what will happen in the future. But with the Eid finished, and inshallah, we intend now to carry on with our lessons as we used to before, regularly, inshallah, azza wa jal, at least three lessons with myself, inshallah, and of course, as well as our khutab, our khutbas and our nasayah to be also streamed and posted and uploaded for yourselves to benefit from and to share, inshallah. Last week, our Shaykh Abu al-Hasanat done his Bangla Life of the Sahaba, which is already available on both Facebook and YouTube, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. And so, bi-idhni azza wa jal, we intend to carry on. In one of the durus that we done last time, you know, or in the last lesson that we done together, we had finished the chapter of honoring the members of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we also spoke about babu tawqir ulama'i wal kibari wa ahli al fadli wa taqdimihim ala ghayrihim wa raf'u majalisihim wa idhharu martabatihim, which means that the chapter of honoring the scholars, elders and the learned persons, and to prefer them and to give them precedence over others, to express their dignity, which is not just something that's cultural, it's in fact a very important part of our religion. It's mentioned in the Quran and is also mentioned, instructed and taught in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we will soon learn bi-idhnillah azza wa jal. We have covered some of these ahadith before, and inshallah bi-idhnillah azza wa jal, I intend to revise some of them with yourselves and perhaps sort of go quickly through the chapter today so that we're on the same page, and next week inshallah we can move on to the next chapter, which is chapter number 45, visiting the holy and virtuous persons and keeping company with them, soliciting their favor and visiting sacred places, inshallah. That's the next bab. But for now, honoring the scholars, elders and learned persons, and to prefer them to others and to express their dignity. Allah says in the Quran, قال الله تعالى قل هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون إنما يتذكر أولو الألباب, that say, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are those who know equal to those who know not? It is only men of understanding who will remember, as in knowing and having ilm is something definitely that has respect and its status and makes a person preferred and stronger and more beloved in the sight of Allah azza wa jal than the person who is not so learned. Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, verily those who fear Allah are his ulama. Allah says also, فَلَوْلَا نَفَرَ مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِّنْهُمْ طَائِفَةٌ لِيَتَفَقَهُ فِي الدِّينِ وَلِيُنْذِرُوا قَوْمَهُمْ إِذَا رَجَعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَحْذَرُونَ, that had they not been from every قوم, فَلَوْلَا نَفَرَ مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِّنْهُمْ طَائِفَةٌ, that had they not been from every group, some of them who go out there and to study the deen so that they can come back and teach their people what they had come back to their communities and propagate and teach and serve their deen in their respective communities. Allah also teaches us from the story of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, هَلْ أَتَّبِعُكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُعَلِّمَنِ مِمَّا عُلِّمْتَ رُشْدًا, when he went to Sayyidina Khadr alayhi salatu wasalam to learn from him and how he followed him and learned from him and the adab of learning and etc. So learning is in fact so central to our deen that Allah azza wa jal, the very first revelation that he sent down to us was اقرأ بِسْمِ رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ, read in the name of your Lord who created. And so reading, learning, is a very important part of our deen. The first hadith which we covered before, and we'll do again inshallah, fourth re'adal, the Prophet Sayyidina عن أبي مسعود عقبة بن عمرو البدري الأنصاري قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم يأم القوم أقرأهم لكتاب الله فإن كانوا في القراءة سواء فأعلمهم بالسنة فإن كانوا في السنة سواء فأقدمهم هجرة فإن كانوا في الهجرة سواء فأقدمهم سنا ولا يؤمن الرجل الرجل في سلطانه ولا يقعد في بيته على تكريمته إلا بإذنه وفي رواية له فأقدمهم سلما بدلا عن سنا أي إسلاما وفي رواية يأم القوم أقرأهم لكتاب الله وأقدمهم قراءة وأقدمهم قراءة فإن كانت قراءتهم سواء فيأمهم أقدمهم هجرة فإن كانوا في الهجرة سواء فليأمهم أكبرهم سنا أبو مسعود عقبة بن عمرو البدري رضي الله عنه الأنصاري narrates from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying that the person who should be the imam in a jama'ah of salah. And being an imam in a jama'ah of salah is something a very great responsibility, and its specification is also allocated by the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we will learn now. But generally speaking, if there is a fixed imam in a masjid, then he has the rights to lead the salah, but if there isn't, then the process of choosing the imam for the salah is as follows. The person who should lead the people in salah is first of all the person who is most well versed in the recitation of the book of Allah, which is the Quran Kareem, should lead the prayer. And if all of those present are equally versed in it, meaning everyone that's present now, there isn't one person who is more knowledgeable than the other person in Quran, or they're all huffaz, for example, right? And in that case, the next criterion by which we measure out who should be the imam is then the one who is most knowledgeable of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, meaning the ahadith and the sunnah and the ayyam and the akhlaq and the adab and the a'mal and the aqwal of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If they are then equal in qira'ah and in sunnah, in Quran and in sunnah, the knowledge of it, then the one who emigrated first to Medina, meaning the one who left the jahiliyyah, or the one who left, of course, at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one who left Mecca for Medina in an effort to leave behind shirk and in an effort to leave behind the societies associated with shirk and to make a change. And so therefore, the person who has been more steadfast on the deen for longer, he gets priority thereafter. If they are equal in this respect also, meaning they're equally hafiz, equally well-versed in sunnah, as well as being equally steadfast on the deen for as long as each other, right? Then the oldest of them, no man should lead another person where the latter. Okay, so then after that, there's a fourth criterion by which we can sieve out who should be the imam. If everyone is the same in the Quran, same in the knowledge of the sunnah, same in their steadfastness on the deen, then the person who is the eldest of them from the group. So age also has an effect on who leads the salah if all of the other criterions have already been measured and they're all same in that regard. Then it says, no man should lead another in a prayer where the latter has authority and sit in his house without his permission. So if someone has been allocated or specified as the imam of a masjid, then that's his space of authority. Or if someone is the imam of the ummah, for example, right? Or if someone, as in the khalifa, or the imam of the masjid, or the person who is the mudarris and the teacher of the madrasa, and so on and so forth. Whoever is in charge of a place has got the rights to lead the salah first, before anyone else. And then he says that no one should sit in the house of another person without their permission. And there are a few other variations in other narrations, but all alluding to the same concept that when it comes to leading of the salah, the first to be given preference to is the best qari. If both the qaris are the same, or if all of the people are present are same in their level of qira'ah, then the most knowledgeable in sunnah, then the most steadfast of them for the longest amount of time, then the eldest also, if they are all same in these all of these regards, then the eldest from them all. The next hadith also narrated from the same Sahabi, رضي الله عنه أرضاه, Okay, he says, قَالَ كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَمْسَحُ مَنَاكِبَنَا فِي الصَّلَاةِ وَيَقُولُ إِسْتَوُوا وَلَا تَخْتَلِفُوا فَتَخْتَلِفَ قُلُوبُكُمْ لِيَلْيَنِي مِنْكُمْ أُولُو الْأَحْلَامِ وَالنُّهَى ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ أَبُو مَسْعُودٍ عُقْبَةَ ابْنِ عَامِرٍ أَوْ عَمْرٍ الْبَجْرِي رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ وَأَرْضَاهُ. Narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would place his hands upon our shoulders when he would form the rows for the prayer, and he would say, stand straight in your rows and do not differ among yourselves, or else your hearts will differ due to discord. Let those be nearest to me who are mature and endowed with understanding of the religion, then those who are the nearest to them in these respects, and then those who are nearest to them. So this is talking about having the completion of the sufuf and having standing shoulder to shoulder and standing close by in a normal circumstance. Now, of course, because of the coronavirus, we have to stand apart because of social distancing, which is also completely permitted, and your salah will be valid. Nonetheless, in normal times, when there isn't a pandemic, when there isn't a fear of the spread of the virus, we should stand. In fact, it's very, very important to stand shoulder to shoulder, to fill in all the gaps, to be same and straight in our rows. This is, of course, as you've heard, alhamdulillah, as we've heard throughout our lifetimes, it's very, very important. And in fact, by not having our suhoof straightened, the threat is, or the fear is, and the warning from the Prophet ﷺ is that your hearts will then become disunited. And then he says the next step is, after making sure that your rows are straight, okay, or as well as making sure that your rows are straight, you should also ensure that the person who's behind the imam is the most eldest of them and the most knowledgeable of them. These are the people that should be right behind the imam, and then the next batch who are the second eldest and the second most knowledgeable, and then the third eldest and the third most knowledgeable, and so on and so forth. So the imam should be followed, or right behind him should be the most senior in our community or in their communities, and the most senior in their knowledge also. That was the second hadith, and all of these, or both of these hadith, have so far showed to us how we should be preferring scholars, or giving honor to scholars, elders, and the learned persons in our community. 350 حديث نمبر 350 says, عن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لياليني منكم أولو الأحلام والنهى ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم. And then he said, ثلاثا وإياكم وهيشات الأسواق. That he says, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, who is a different Sahabi, is narrating that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, let those be nearest to me in prayer who are mature and possess religious knowledge or knowledge of the deen of al-Islam, then those who are nearest to them in these respects. He repeated these three times and then added, beware of indulging in the loose talks of the marketplaces when you are in the masjids, meaning the masjid should not be filled up with hayshat al-aswaq, or the sounds and the shouting and the noise and the muttering and the gossiping of the marketplaces, meaning the masjid is a place of ibadah, it's a blessed place, it's a place of malaika, it's a place of being near to Allah, calling to Allah, sujood to Allah, dua to Allah, sincerity to Allah, and therefore it should not be filled up with anything or have anything with it that opposes and is in contradiction to the adab and the akhlaq of the masjid, which includes shouting and screaming and gossiping and talking for no reason. 351 عن أبي محمد سهل بن أبي حيثمة الأنصاري قال انطلق عبد الله بن سهل ومحيصة ابن مسعود إلى خيبر وهي يومئذ صلحون فتفرقا فأتى محيصة إلى عبد الله بن سهل وهو يتشحط في دمه قتيلا فدفنه ثم قدم المدينة فانطلق عبد الرحمن بن سهل ومحيصة وحويصة ابن مسعود إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فذهب عبد الرحمن يتكلم فقال كبر كبر وهو أحدث القوم فسكت فتكلم فقال أتحلفون وتستحقون قاتلكم. Amazing hadith being narrated by Sahl ibn Abu Haythama, or Sahl ibn Abu Hathma, Al-Ansari radiallahu anhu arda, narrated that Abdullah ibn Sahl and Muhawisa ibn Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Sahl and Muhawisa ibn Mas'ud are both cousin brothers. They both went, may Allah be pleased with them, both went to Khaybar during the time of a truce, meaning they both traveled from Medina to Khaybar. Abdullah ibn Sahl and Muhayyusa, they're both cousins, and they go to Khaybar, and they separated to perform their duties, to go two different ways to do their things. When Muhayyusa returned to Abdullah ibn Sahl, so now they are about to go back to Medina. They now come together together to find one another. But then when Muhayyusa radiallahu anhu comes, he finds Abdullah ibn Sahal radiallahu anhu was murdered in Khaybar, drenched in his blood. So he buried him and returned to Medina. So what he done was, he, Abdullah ibn Sahal, was murdered, and so when Abdullah ibn Sahal radiallahu anhu was murdered, and so he murdered Muhayyusa radiallahu anhu, or Muhayyusa radiallahu anhu, buried him, and then he went on to go to Medina. Then Abdurrahman ibn Sahal and Hawisa and Muhawisa, or Abdullah ibn Sahal, okay, so okay, so Hawisa and Muhawisa and Abdullah ibn Abdurrahman ibn Sahal radiallahu anhum ardahum, all three of them. So Abdullah ibn Sahal has been murdered. Okay, Muhawisa is alive, he comes back. Then he is joined by two other Sahabis. Okay, Hawisa, and you have Abdurrahman ibn Sahal radiallahu anhu wa arda. Who is Abdurrahman? Abdurrahman ibn Sahal radiallahu anhu is the brother of Abdullah ibn Sahal. Abdullah ibn Sahal was the man that got murdered in Khaybar. And so now Abdurrahman ibn Sahal is very upset, and is very, of course, shocked by what the news that he's heard. And so they all go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam together. Okay, and so they all went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to explain to him the situation. But of course, Abdurrahman ibn Sahal, being the brother of Abdullah ibn Sahal, automatically started to speak first. But my brother got murdered in Khaybar. But he wasn't the eldest of them. He was, in fact, the youngest of all of the three that were present, Muhawisa and Hawisa and Abdurrahman ibn Sahal. The youngest of them was Abdurrahman ibn Sahal. And so, even though the Prophet ﷺ knew the person that Abdurrahman ibn Sahal is talking about is his own blood brother, and yet, when he began to talk before his elders, his elder cousins, okay, the Prophet ﷺ said to them, let those older than you speak first. So he stopped talking, and the other two spoke about the case of their murdered friend. The Prophet ﷺ said, will you take an oath whereby you will have the right to receive the blood money of your murdered man? And was mentioned, and so he basically said, he spoke to them first. But the point, the shahid here is, what we're trying to learn from the hadith is how the Prophet ﷺ told the elders to speak first and asked the younger of them to wait until the elders had finished speaking and narrating the incident and the story. This is to learn, again, going back to the title once again, honoring the scholars, elders, and the learned persons in the community, to prefer them to others and to express their dignity. 352 عن جابر رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يجمع بين الرجلين من قتل أحد يعني في القبر ثم يقول أيهما أكثر أخذا للقرآن فإذا أشير إلى أحدهما قدمه إلى اللحد. This hadith is being narrated by Abdullah ibn Jabir ibn Abdullah رضي الله عنه, who was from the younger of the Sahaba رضوان الله عليهم أجمعين. He is saying the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he was burying the shuhada of Uhud, what he would do is he gathered the shuhada, those who'd been murdered and those who'd been martyred, in Uhud, and he would say, who of the deceased is more, who knows more of the Quran, who knows more portions of the Quran of that which had been revealed up to then. And so when he was told that this one or this person or this sahabi, this shaheed is more knowledgeable than the other in the Quran, and he is more of a hafiz than the other, then he would allow for him and permit for him and ask for him to be buried first as an honor for him, that he is buried first before the others because he is a hafiz of the Quran. So this is again supporting the title and the chapter, which is honoring the knowledgeable, the elders and the scholars in the community. Same lesson but from a different incident. 353 عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أراني في المنام أتسوك بسواك فجاءني رجلان أحدهما أكبر من الآخر فناولت السواك الأصغر فقيل لي كبر فدفعته إلى الأكبر منهما. عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنه, who was one of the scholars of the Sahaba, who was one of the youngest of the Sahaba, who is the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله عنه وأرضاه, is narrating the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, is saying, it was shown to me in a dream that I saw a dream in which I was cleaning my teeth with a miswak, and then two men came to me, and the one being older and the other being younger. The Prophet ﷺ is saying that I saw myself in the dream that I gave my miswak to the younger one. But I was asked and I heard a voice in the dream telling me that I should give the miswak to the elder one, which I did, he's saying that. So this again goes to show that this honoring that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam done to the two people that came, that he saw in his dream, the fact that he gave it or he was instructed to give to the elder one first, was a clear lesson of respect and honor, which is required and an integral part of our deen, which is a very important part of the Sharia, and we should all maintain and bear in mind. Of course, we're just reading through the hadith, but let's bear in mind the situation that we are in, as in how our society nowadays has completely disregarded or discarded the importance of respecting elders. In fact, there is more respect, the whole concept of respect for elders has completely become, it's something of the past now. There's hardly do you find a young person who's respecting his elders for being older, or even respect for ulama, respect for huffaz, respect for etc. This is very, very important and is very clearly evident from the Quran, from the Sunnah that we are studying now. 354. An Abi Musa al-Ash'ari radiyallahu anhu qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna min ijlalillahi ta'ala ikramu dhil shaybati al-muslimi wa hamil al-Qur'ani ghayr al-ghali fihi wal-jafi anhu wa ikrama dhil sultani al-muqsiti. Abu Musa radiyallahu anhu narrates the Prophet ﷺ, we spoke about Abu Musa al-Ash'ari in our previous lessons. He is from the Sahaba that came from Yemen. He was from the most beautiful reciters of the Quran from the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ. He is narrating the Prophet ﷺ said to him, it is out of thee. So he is saying that the Prophet ﷺ said, it is out of reverence to Allah in respecting the aged Muslim and the one who commits the Quran to memory and does not exaggerate pronouncing it, its letters, nor forgets it after memorizing it, and to respect the just ruler. Meaning from the honors that Allah Azza wa Jal has honored people with is to honor the aged Muslim, meaning the elders in our community, to respect them is a part of the command of Allah Azza wa Jal, is from the honoring of Allah Azza wa Jal himself that he has honored them with, and so therefore it is our responsibility to give them that the honor that they deserve. And the one who has committed the Quran to his memory, half of the Quran should be honored, especially when he pronounces it correctly, recites it with ahkam al-tajweed, and recites it beautifully, and does not forget it. And to respect also the just ruler, the hakim or the imam or the qadi, or the one who is ruling a society, a community, a country, if he is just and fair, to also respect that person is also a part of honoring Allah Azza wa Jalla's demands. 355. عن عمرو بن شعيب عن أبيه عن جده رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليس منا من لم يرحم صغيرنا ويعرف شرف كبيرنا. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying in this hadith narrated by Amr ibn Shu'ayb radiyallahu anhu from his father, from his jad, from his grandfather, he is saying that on the authority, he is saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, he is not from us who shows no mercy to his youngsters or younger ones, and does not acknowledge the honor due to our elders. Meaning if we don't respect our elders and if we don't be kind to our youngsters, then this isn't a complete part of being a follower of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not completing our iman, it's not completing our ittiba' or the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as it's his command to do so, to respect the elders and to be kind to the and show mercy to the youngsters and to the children in our community or generally. 356. عن ميمون ابن شبيب رحمه الله أن عائشة رضي الله عنها مر بها سائل فأعطته كسرة ومر بها رجل عليه ثياب وهيئة فأقعدته فأكل فقيل لها في ذلك فقالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنزل الناس منازلهم. This is very important and we often forget this, which is ميمون ابن أبي شبيب رضي الله عنه وأرضاه رحمه الله narrated that a beggar passed by Aisha radiyallahu anha wa ardaha for charity. So he is narrating from the Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha that a beggar passed by her for charity and said, can you give me some charity? And she gave him a piece of bread. That was what he asked for, and that's what he demanded, and so she gave him that. Thereafter, a well-dressed person asked her for charity, and she invited him to sit down and served him food. The first one gave the food or gave the bread and allowed him to move on. The second one, he appeared to be a respectable and honorable person, a guest perhaps in the area, and so instead of just giving him some bread and telling him to move on, she said, sit down, and gave him food. And when she was asked about the reason for the difference in the treatment, the hadith is saying, she said that the Prophet ﷺ has instructed us that treat people according to their status. And so treating everyone the same way isn't justice, isn't fair, isn't from the sunnah. It is from the sunnah to treat people according to their status. If a person is a alim, to honor him because of his ilm. If a person is a hafiz, to honor him because of his hifz. If a person is a da'i, to honor him because of that. Whoever is honored in society, whoever should be honored in society should be honored. And whoever is not of that caliber or that category of honored, then of course you should still honor them, but it's not the same as a person who should be honored for their knowledge or for a reason. A doctor, an engineer, a qualified person, someone who's serving the community, a hafiz, a alim, an imam, a scholar, a da'i, a mufakir, and the people who are serving the community who deserve respect should be respected. And it's so important to realize that, because this is slowly, slowly fading away from our community. Next hadith is 357 عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال قدم عيينة بن حصن فنزل على ابن أخيه الحر بن قيس وكان من النفر الذين يدنيهم عمر رضي الله عنه وكان القراء أصحاب مجلس عمر ومشاورته كهولا كانوا أو شبانا فقال عيينة لابن أخيه يا ابن أخي لك وجه عند هذا الأمير فاستأذن لي عليه فأذن له عمر فلما دخل قال هي ابن الخطاب فوالله ما تعطينا الجزل ولا تحكم فينا العدل عدل ولا تحكم فينا بالعدل فغضب عمر رضي الله عنه حتى هم أن يوقع به فقال له الحر يا أمير المؤمنين إن الله تعالى قال لنبيه خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين وإن هذا من الجاهلين والله ما جاوزها عمر حين تلاها عليه وكان وقافا عند كتاب الله تعالى. عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنه is narrating that Uyayn ibn Hisn came to Medina, okay, and his nephew Al-Hur ibn Qais. So Uyayn ibn Hisn was from the leaders of the time, and he arrived in Medina, and so he stayed with his nephew Al-Hur ibn Qais, who was among those who were close to radiyallahu anhu, who was among those who were close to Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu wa arda, and had access to his counsel. The point to learn from here is Al-Hur ibn Qais, okay, he is young. Nonetheless, he has access to the counsel of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu because of his knowledge, because he was from the Qurra, from the Ulama, and etc. So he says, he explains, the scholarly persons, whether they were old or young, had the privilege of joining his counsel, and he used to consult them. That Sayyidina Umar would consult the youngsters or youngers, all the elders, as long as they were ulama and they were respected people in the community, or if they were knowledgeable, sorry. Uyayna said to Al-Hur, my dear nephew, you have access to the leader of the believers, meaning you have the invitation to join Umar radiallahu anhu's council. Will you obtain permission for me to sit with him? Al-Hur asked Umar for this permission, and he accorded with permission. When Uyayna came into the presence of Umar, he addressed him thus, O son of Al-Khattab. So now this person is addressing Umar ibn Khattab, saying, O Al-Khattab, you neither bestow upon much on us nor deal with us justly. Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, got angry and was about to beat him when Al-Hur ibn Qais radiallahu anhu says that, O leader of the believers, Allah said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, show forgiveness and enjoin what is good and turn away from the foolish, i.e. don't punish them. And so when he recited this, Al-Hur ibn Qais, straight away Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu stopped, even though he was angry, because he was accused of not dealing justly or not dealing fairly. So, but because this ayah was recited to say, show forgiveness, enjoin what is good, and turn away from the foolish, al-jahileen, and don't punish them, right? So Hur said that this person, my uncle, is one of the ignorant ones. Even though he's my uncle, nonetheless, he is one of the ignorant ones. By Allah, when Hur recited this ayah in front of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, Umar became quiet and motionless in his seat. He always adhered strictly to the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. So many things to learn. The respect of ulama, how they were part of the council regardless of their age, and that ilm is something that gains or gives honor to all of those regardless of their age. How Sayyidina Umar was very strictly abiding by the ayah of the kitab. In fact, if someone told any of us perhaps that, you know, isbir ala ma yaqulun, when you're angry, or khudh al-afwa wa'mur bil-urf, when you're angry, then you may get more angry as opposed to calming down. Whereas the example is different, that we should, when we hear the Quranic ayah, we should stop. That should be the end of it. That should be the end of the discussion and the debate. 358 عن أبي سعيد سمرة ابن جندب قال لقد كنت على عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم غلاما فكنت أحفظ عنه فما يمنعني من القول إلا أنها هنا رجالا هم أسن مني أبو سعيد سمرة ابن جندب. May Allah be pleased with him, narrated, I was a boy during the lifetime of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and used to commit what he, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, would say to my memory. But I do not narrate what I preserve, because they were among us people who were older than me. And so because there were elders in his presence, he would not narrate or he would not speak before the elders, or even, you know, speak of knowledge before them, because that's out of the respect of the elders once again. So much to learn from here again, once again. You know, we see that nowadays, subhanAllah, you know, we learn a bit of knowledge and then we decide to start speaking before our elders, before our seniors, before our scholars, before the specialists of the field, and so on. 359 عن أنس رضي الله عنه عن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أكرم شاب شيخا لسنه إلا قيض الله له من يكرمه عند سنه. This is amazing, this hadith. Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Prophet ﷺ has said, if a young man honors an elderly person or an older person on account of his age, if a young person respects an elder person, okay, when he's young and the other person's old, Allah appoints someone to show reverence to him, to this young person, when he gets old. So basically, what goes around comes around. كَمَا تَدِينُ تُدَانُ. What, the way you treat your elders is how you will be treated when you are old as well. This is very important to remember, and it's very similar case when it comes to parents respecting, honoring, obedience to our parents, kindness to them. If we are harmful to them, harsh to them, rude to them, disrespectful to them, disobedient to them, then this will only come back and affect us and harm us in the future. These are hadith and many more that have not been collected here, and Quranic ayat which have not been mentioned here, all indicate to the honoring of the scholars, elders, and the learned persons in the society, and to prefer them to others and to express their dignity, which is very, very important. And in fact, we know that from the alamat of the sa'ah, from the signs of the qiyamah, is that Allah Azza wa Jal will lift knowledge and take away knowledge from this world. And this taking away of knowledge from this world will not be by removing or deleting what's on, for example, the online sites or what's in the books. In fact, it will be by the death of the ulama. And so therefore, the preservation of this deen and the preservation of knowledge, preservation of the Quran has been done through ulama, through scholars, through huffaz, extremely honored in the sight of Allah. A person who is a student of knowledge, من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له طريقا إلى الجنة, whomsoever seeks a path to seek knowledge, whomsoever is on a path to seek knowledge, Allah makes his path to Jannah easy. Allahu Akbar. Whomsoever. Other hadith teach us that even the malaika lower their wings out of honor for the student of knowledge, and that every single thing makes dua for the student of knowledge, even the fish in the ocean, because the fish in the ocean and the fish in the sea make dua for the student of knowledge, because it is by the da'wah and it is by the works of the students of knowledge and the ulama that the deen is maintained in this world. It is by the sacrifice and the studying and the propagation of the students of knowledge and ulama that the deen is maintained in this world. And had the propagation of the deen stopped, then the world would be filled up with disobedience, jahala, kufr, and etc. And if the world is filled up with jahala, kufr, and disobedience, and shirk, and etc., then Allah Azza wa Jal's wrath afflicts everybody. And when the punishment comes, everyone is affected. And so because the presence of ulama and tullabul ilm and ahlul ilm is a rahmah, this rahmah doesn't just benefit the person, it benefits their families, benefits their societies, benefits their communities, benefits the entire world, even benefits the fish in the ocean, and so therefore they make dua, even the fish in the ocean make dua for the student of knowledge and the ulama, those who are seeking and protecting and revising and propagating and teaching the knowledge of Allah, of Islam, that Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed unto us through the revelation. Allah says in the Quran, or the Prophet ﷺ said in the Hadith, that خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلم, the best of you are those who teach the Quran and or teach it. And so anyone that teaches any science that's related to the Quran and his origins are from the Quran is in fact in this hadith also, that the best of you are those who teach and learn, especially that's ilm al-nafi'a, that we ask Allah Azza wa Jalla, Allahumma inni as'aluka ilm al-nafi'a, wa Allah, we seek from you beneficial knowledge, wa amalan saliha, wa rizqan wasi'a, wa shifa'an min kulli da'a, amin rabbil alameen. Jazakum Allahu khairan for your presence and for your attendance and for your listening and for your understanding and for your practicing, inshallah Azza wa Jalla. Subhanakallahum, ashadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruk wa atubu ilayk, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.